Good evening, all of you. So today we are going to continue with chapter 3, history. Okay, and what is the name of the chapter? It is chapter 3 and it is the Delhi Sultans. If you remember, we talked about few things earlier. Actually, it's a very long chapter, so it is taking a lot of time also. But the most important thing, it is talking about each and everything about Delhi Sultanate. Means Delhi Sultans. It's talking each and everything about Delhi Sultan. So undoubtedly we need to focus on it very much. So yesterday when we talked about this Delhi Sultans, we finally got to know that the people who were here that time, like at the time of Khaljis or at the time of Tughlaqs, what we studies. Basically I'm talking about the, as they were the Muslims, so what they started doing, they started making mosque, means masjid, in India. Just for what? To show their power and to show, to also to preserve their community. So they started making mosque, mean masjid, in India. After that, we get to know a closer look, administration and consolidation under the Khaljis and Tughlaqs. So when we talk about this chapter, we basically know, because when we talk about administration, we talk about that who is the person governing, what kind of things are going on. So here what we find, that there were a number of governors appointed initially. And the most important part was who should be a very reliable person. Means the official whosoever was being elected or being chosen by Khaljis or Tughlaqs. The person was supposed to be very trustworthy. Then only the ruler could or the sultan could have fully trust on that person, and then only the person could do anything, right? Like it could flourish. Else though, it's very difficult for any kind of kingdom if they don't have trustworthy employees. So it's very difficult for that particular kingdom to work. So what started, means here comes that Iltutmish started something strange, something very different, that he was having a belief that my gulams, like my slaves, are very much trustworthy to me. So what I will do, I will appoint these people as my employees, as my chieftain, as my governors in different areas. And undoubtedly these people who were also known as bandagans, if you go for this word, these people were also known as bandagan. So if you go for this word bandagan, so these were the people also known as bandagan. Okay, so here we find that these were the people, and these bandagans were appointed by the rulers, right? For different officials they were elected. Later on we find, if you remember that I told you, I taught you that these people were very, and they had the poet, they had the scholars who used to write for them. So they were giving suggestions also. Initially it was undoubtedly appreciated by those people, because by the rulers, by the poets and by the scholars, that yes, they have appointed very trustworthy people. But there was also a criticism against the rulers, that the rulers were suggested, don't appoint your slaves, or if you are appointing your slaves, the people are supposed to be very experienced, they are supposed to be knowledgeable. You just imagine, there was a ruler and who appointed his barber, a ruler who appointed his servant. So these kind of things, if something happens, you just see here, Muhammad Tughlaq appointed his dizzler, his barber. He appointed his dizzler, okay. He appointed his barber, a cook, gardener, like on a very high post. Do you think the people who are the barbers or the gardeners, who are not educated, who don't have education, who don't have much knowledge, much experience, will they work? So here came the criticism against those people also, these kind of ruler also, that whether you're appointing very trustworthy people, but the problem is, these people are supposed to be eligible also for it. But finally what happens, these people are not eligible here. Then we find that these people started appointing these kind of people, right? Then we find that at the time when, for an example, Iltutmish has appointed a slave who is very trustworthy to him, but it is not sure that the son of Iltutmish, means after Iltutmish became Razia Sultan. So it is not sure that these slaves will be responsible, will be that much trustworthy to Razia Sultan only, also, because they are basically responsible, trustworthy to only to their masters, not to somebody else. And many times the new generation was also thinking, why your people, why my father's servants, why don't I take my people? So this also created a lot of conflict, and that was a main problem which occurred that time, at the time of Tughlaq's or at the time of Khalji, both the time it was a problem which was created and which came up. Now we are coming to the next part, that yes, it happened that who were the officials appointed, right? Now, you also know the whole Delhi Sultanate or Delhi Sultan Empire was spreaded over a vast area, like western part, eastern part, central part and the southern part of India. Do you think it was easy to control over this area? Undoubtedly, no. So what they started doing, they started appointing governors, that we got to know. They started appointing officers, officials. We also got to know about it. But what they were doing, the way you are finding that India is having a number of states or states are having a number of districts, the same way governor did that time. What he did, he started dividing the land. Okay, he divided the land into different parts, and which was actually this particular land. This particular land was known as Ikta, and the person who was supposed to be the head of it, remember, land part was known as Ikta, land was known as Ikta, and person who was the head of that particular land, that person was known as Iktadar or Mukti. Remember, a person, land part was known as Ikta, and the person who was the head of an Ikta, means of that particular land part, that person was known as Iktadar or he was known as Mukti. Okay, now the matter comes, what was the work of this person? What the ruler did, Sultan did, he divided the entire into a number of Iktas, right? Now Ikta was having one head who was known as Iktadar and Mukti. But the matter comes, for what purpose this person was appointed? So the person was, he had to lead military campaigns. Military campaign means in different part of the area, the person has to go and he has to continue grabbing other land. And second thing is, first military campaign, second thing is maintaining law and order, means peace. Any kind of conflict occurs, the person is supposed to be responsible for it, the person is supposed to maintain peace over there, right? So this was the main work, that he has to lead military campaign, he has to maintain law and order. Now what in return the person will get? Because if any person is appointed, he is doing a lot of work, so the person will get salary also for it. So what kind of salary, what kind of thing the person is getting back? So you just see, in exchange for their military services, because as they were providing military services, so in exchange for their military services, the Muktis collected the revenues of their assignments as salary. So you just see, they were the head of Ikta, and Ikta was a land part, big land part. So what was happening, Ikta, these Muktis had to collect tax or revenue from these Iktas, and what they could do, they were not supposed to give it to the ruler. No, they were not, actually the revenue was fixed by the Sultan that time. So this person had to give a military campaign, he had to lead military campaign, and this person was taking care of this particular Ikta. So the person was responsible to collect taxes. He was collecting taxes from the Iktas, and what he was doing with the taxes, he was not giving it back to the king. It was the salary of that Mukti. So whatever the land he has got, he is the head of, he has to collect taxes from it. And what he will do, he will manage with his salary. He will manage with his salary. Along with that, he has his old soldiers, like he has, you know, his own army. So he has to feed the army also. Means the salary of Mukti along with the salary of the military. So it was all collected together, right? So we got to know this. Now the ruler was having a feeling, oh my God, if every time Mukti is only collecting the taxes, he is doing everything, he is having a military campaign, so how will I manage? How can I control on that part? So the ruler, means Sultan, was taking care of one thing, that go and check. He was sending his officials to go and check whether Mukti is collecting, whether Mukti is not collecting. He should not collect more taxes which is applied. Means the government has decided, Sultan had decided the amount of tax, the Mukti cannot take more than the tax. Along with that, Mukti is allotted with number of soldiers, that you have to keep soldiers, but you cannot keep more and more soldiers. It is limited. Tax is limited for you to collect. Soldiers are limited for you to maintain. So these were the things which were controlled by Tughlaqs also and Khaljis also. So what we find here, in both the cases, Tughlaqs and Khaljis, which are doing somewhat common, right? But when we talk about Khaljis and when we talk about Tughlaqs, we find one thing missing here. And what that thing is, one got a failure, another got a success. There may be some other reasons. So we'll talk about it now. So here, what we found, we basically found about this thing. You just see here what happens. So here we find that the Sultan, now we find here, as the Delhi Sultan brought the hinterland, as you know, they were having the hinterland, right? So hinterland means the area which was providing the goods and service to the empire, to the kingdom. So here we find that as Delhi Sultan brought the hinterland of the cities under their control, they forced the landed chieftains, Samantha and aristocrats and rich landowners to accept their authority. Means undoubtedly this problem would be there. They have hinterland under their control, and who is there? So the people who are having big land, the big land owners, they who were known as Samanthas. Okay, so Samanthas were the big land owners. So what happened here, they said that, like the ruler said, that it is not acceptable that one big land part is under the control of Samantha. No, we will not accept it. So they just started forcing those Samanthas, those rich landowners, they started forcing them that you have to come under my control. And if you don't come under my control, I will not allow you for anything. So first, these rich people came under their control. And now king took the authority that he was supposed to collect the taxes from that. Means he appointed the people, and they just appointed the local chieftain. They were collecting the taxes and they were giving it to the Sultan. So this way the whole it started working. Now the matter comes, as we are talking about the taxes and the revenues. So let me tell you what kind of taxes were there. As you know, we are having taxes nowadays on different things or different items, like we are having goods and services taxes. Anything you purchase, you have tax on it. You have to give the transportation tax. You have house official tax, like house tax, many kind of tax you have. That time there were three kind of tax. One tax was on cultivation called kharaz. Okay, cultivation means there was a kind of tax which was known as kharaz. So it was a kind of tax. What it was? 50% of the peasants produce. If you remember class 6, it was the tax 1/6, means sixth part of the from the peasants. Now you just see Khalji and Tughlaq, they started taking 50% of the peasants produce. Do you feel it is acceptable? Undoubtedly no. Second, on cattle, any person who is having cattle, the person has to pay tax. And on houses, any person who is having houses, that person have to pay the tax. So there were three kinds of taxes available that time. One was 50% from the peasants, from the peasantry. Second, cattle, and third one was houses. So here we find three kind of taxes are available. Now, it is important to remember, it was very difficult to control the whole area, as it was like available to the vast, it was it had expanded to the vast area. So what we find that some other areas started going back to it. Means in the even in the Gangetic Plain, you just see what happened. It was difficult to control distant provinces like Bengal from Delhi, and soon after annexing southern India, the entire region became independent. Even in the Gangetic Plain, there were forested area. You just see what happened. They started initially, they captured all the areas, but what happened later? They could not control those areas, and it was the main problem. And again, created a problem. It was the end of Delhi Sultanate. Okay, it was the end of Delhi Sultanate. How? It was only the time when the Mughals entered. Mughal entered. When you come to chapter 4 in this book, means class 7, chapter 4, you will get to know the Mongol, yeah, here about Genghis Khan, who was Mongol. Then they started capturing. After that, we find that Mongolias, they started capturing their areas. So Mongol attacks on the Delhi Sultanate increased during the reign of Alauddin Khalji and in the early years of Muhammad Tughlaq's rule. And what happened? This forced the two rulers to mobilize a large standing army in Delhi, which posed a huge administrative challenge. So you just see what happened. So as they started getting a lot of a number of attacks from the Mongols, so now they had to focus more and more on Delhi instead of focusing on other areas. So the other areas which were earlier under the control of this Tughlaqs and Khaljis, they came out of it. So it became a small, not very big. Okay. And after that, what happened? They had to spend a lot of money on one thing, and what it was? For military campaign, because any time when Mongols attack, they should be there in a situation to control all that. Now we are coming to the last of, to the end of this, which is a very important question. We've talked about Alauddin Khalji, we talked about Tughlaqs, we talked about both, but there is a great difference between Tughlaqs and Khaljis. So what we find, who was more successful? We need to talk about that. So let me tell you, if we talk on this question, it is a very important question for you. Differentiate between the administration. Remember, differentiate between the administration of Alauddin Khalji and Muhammad Tughlaq, or who was better? The question may also come, who was better? So you just see, at the time of Alauddin Khalji, Delhi was attacked twice in 1299 to this and this to this, raised a large standing army. So Alauddin found that as they have got two times attack from the Mongols, so they started making a always standing army. Standing army means always which is ready for everything, right? What Muhammad Tughlaq did, you just see. Mongol army, initially what they did, Mongol army was defeated. So what he did, he was very confident. Okay. Tughlaq was very confident about the strength of his army and his resources to plan an attack. So what he found? Alauddin raised a standing army. He made his army more powerful. Alauddin and Tughlaq was very much confident that yes, I can easily control over this area. Now what Alauddin did? Alauddin, to have a kind of plan, he constructed a new garrison town. If you remember, garrison town means what? The whole area which is where the soldiers are living. So Alauddin constructed a new garrison town. What Tughlaq did, because both of them were attacked by Mongols, so both of them are having different kind of planning. One made a large standing army. Undoubtedly, if somebody is having large standing army, it will expense a lot. If anybody is having garrison town, it will also expense a lot. Now you just see what Muhammad did. Rather than constructed a new garrison town, the oldest of the four cities of Delhi was imputed of its resident and soldiers were there. Means this person made a new town and this person said, no, I will not make a new town. I will make this place, the old cities are there, so I will manage with that only. Let's see what else happened. at the time of Khalji, we find soldiers had to be fed. Undoubtedly, they need salary. Undoubtedly, so what happened? This was done through the produce collected as the tax from the land between the Ganga and Yamuna. And what was the tax fixed? The tax fixed was 50%. Okay. So now what we find, what he did, what Muhammad Tughlaq did, he said produce from the same area was collected. Now he said there was something else. So we find here produce from the same area was collected as tax to feed the army. Produce from the same area and was collected. So, but to meet the expense of maintaining such a large army, number of soldiers, Sultan had levied additional taxes. So you just imagine, they had fixed 50%, he added additional tax. Let's see what happens. Soldiers had to be paid. So what the soldiers did, what he did, Alauddin said, okay, we'll pay the salary in cash rather than ikta. We will not pay ikta, because earlier they were getting ikta land part and they had to collect tax from the land part, they had to manage with it. Alauddin said, no, I will not give more iktas to anybody. I will give them salary in form of cash. Whatever they want, I'll provide them in form of cash. So what he did, he controlled the prices of goods. And for that, what he did a lot of things. The soldiers would buy their supplies from merchants in Delhi, and it was thus feared that merchants would raise their prices. They were undoubtedly, if we are in need of more and more thing, what happens? It is the time of black marketing, right? So the Alauddin said, no, it cannot happen. The way now the government is doing now, that there should be no black marketing. So Alauddin fixed the price of each and everything, so that the people could not ask for, the businessmen could not ask for more money. But Muhammad Tughlaq, what he did? He also paid his soldiers a tax, but instead of controlling prices, he used a token currency. So they started getting a kind of token, but made out of very cheap metal, not gold or silver. So you just see here, we find that they saved their gold and silver coins and paid all their taxes to the state with their token currency, means a new kind of currency. Alauddin introduced that, okay, I'll pay the salary. Tughlaq also said, I will pay the salary. Alauddin said, I will pay the salary, but in cash. Whatever currency is there, I'll pay in cash. But if there is a demand, because soldiers will now go to purchase, so the businessmen will raise their price. So he said, okay, no issues. I will not allow the people to raise the price. So what he said, he controlled everything. So there will be no black marketing. Merchant cannot raise their price. Okay. Means if any merchant is selling out of the price, more than the price, the merchant will be punished. Muhammad Tughlaq said, okay, no, I will also pay in cash. But what will I do? I will announce a new kind of currency, which is known as token currency. But the problem is, okay, it is made up of not a very good quality. But to make it is a big task, na? You have to manage with that lot, right? You have to manage with it a lot. So now the matter comes finally. Alauddin's administrative measures were quite successful and chroniclers praised his reign. I mean, the people who were writing, like they were known as the chroniclers. So they said, okay, that was very good. Whatever Alauddin did, it was successful. But Tughlaq's administration was a failure. Why failure? Because he started a token currency and he could not manage with it for more time. Because token currency means more and more production of the currency, but he couldn't go for it. When he couldn't go for it, undoubtedly he could not manage with it, and it was a failure and it was a great success for him. So finally, what we find that when we talk about this, when we talk about this system, or when we talk about the Tughlaqs and Khaljis, overall, all the sultans were very great, undoubtedly. All the sultans were great. But here what we find, one, these two were very important, like Tughlaqs and Khaljis were more important because they governed here for more amount of time. But when we compared Tughlaqs and Khaljis, we find both of had the same kind of problem, and the problem was from the Mongols. And here Alauddin Khalji had his own plan, Tughlaq had his own plan. But one plan got success, another plan couldn't. So there are a number of reasons, and we got to know the reasons behind it, okay? Especially the token currency was a main problem. Making the old city, converting the old city into garrison town and shifting the capital to Daulatabad could bear a more expense. But Alauddin Khilji did better because he just took one place and he just appointed all the officials over there, means all the soldiers over there. So one area only became the garrison town, and he fixed the price also. Tughlaq couldn't control all those things. So when you talk about all these things, we basically find that this was the whole done, and overall we find Alauddin Khalji was better. He was a better and he was a successful ruler or sultan instead of Muhammad Tughlaq. So for now I'm just ending up the session, and for tomorrow, I hope tomorrow we'll be able to finish this chapter and we'll start with the next one. Okay, by the time, thank you so much. Just let me know if you have any doubt. Do you have any doubt right now? If you have any doubt, you just let me know. If no doubt, so you can leave. Even you can ask your doubt in the comment box also, right now in the chat box or later on in the comment box. So both the options are clear to you. I will be there. Okay, if your voice was not clear, why don't you have a doubt? That's a question. Okay, bye. Take care.